So last video, I spent 3 months porting Scratch to the 3DS. It was way more work than I thought it would be, but in the end, it works alright, I guess. A lot of people were really excited about this when I posted the video. People who wanted to make 3DS homebrew but couldn't because they only knew how to code in Scratch now could because of me, which I think is pretty cool. I did think for a little bit, though, that this would be the start of the slop apocalypse in the homebrew scene because of how easy it is to make games in Scratch, but luckily that hasn't happened. Yet. It hasn't happened yet. If it does happen, I'm sorry, my bad, it just had to happen, you know. I was pretty content with what I made and decided that I would take a break since I'd been fully locked in on this for a while and thought that I could finally just take a break and relax. But then the video blew up. A lot of people in the comments were saying how it would be cool if this was also ported to the Wii or the Switch or the DS, and I thought to myself, nah, I'd have to rewrite like everything for each of the platforms, and I didn't want to do all that. But looking into it more, all of the code that actually interprets the Scratch blocks is just normal C++ code. All I would really need to do is code the console-specific things, like rendering and the controls and stuff. A sinister, putrid thought came into my head at that point. What if I put Scratch everywhere? The first platform I decided to port this to was PC. A PC port at first sounds like a waste of time since obviously you can already use Scratch on PC, but I decided I wanted to do a PC port since firstly it would be the easiest one to do, and secondly a PC port would make it easier to fix bugs because trying to debug on a 3DS is quite the task. So I actually started the PC port really early on to help with this. The first thing I would need to do is separate all the 3DS specific code away from the Scratch code. So I had to find everywhere I was using 3DS code, even just for tiny things like how one of the blocks makes it open the keyboard. I had to separate all of that into 3DS specific files. Then in the 3DS's makefile, I can tell it to only compile the 3DS code and the Scratch code, not any of the other code from the other platforms that I eventually make. Speaking of which, now that it's all separated, I have to actually start making the PC port, which means I have to pick a library that's able to render images, do input, and maybe some extra things, I don't know. There's a lot of libraries to choose from, and I ultimately landed on SDL2. SDL2 lets you do image rendering, input with both keyboard and mouse and controller, audio, font rendering, other stuff I forgot. And the best part about SDL2 is that it has ports for everything. You can use SDL2 with PC, with the Wii, Wii U, PlayStation, Xbox, even the 3DS. Bro, this is crazy. This theoretically means that all the code I write for this PC port will just work everywhere on every platform and I wouldn't have to do anything at all. Theoretically, at least. Now I just have to learn SDL2. Can't be that hard, right? I spent a couple of days in a new project just to mess around with it. I was looking at a bunch of random articles about image rendering and how SDL2 works in general. I was able to cobble together a new class for images that can rotate, scale, and flip, which is pretty cool. I didn't want to mess with the other things SDL2 does, like audio or font rendering, so I just copied the code that I had and pasted it into the Scratch project. Then I had to code the Scratch-specific rendering stuff, like calculating the position correctly, which was kind of annoying since now I have two different files doing a very similar thing, but just different enough that I can't share a lot of the code between it. But after that, it was just as simple as making a makefile for the PC version, compiling it, and I was able to just run it. I can run it on both Linux and Windows. Yes, that is a DS-shaped Windows handheld. I will not be taking any further questions. With the PC port done, I went back to fixing bugs and stuff for the 3DS version for a few days. This is around the time when I posted the last video, and wow. Can I just say how much I love open source software? Since my runtime is open source, anyone can just steal my code for themselves, or even better, contribute back to the project. Within the next couple of months or so, I went from just coding this myself to having 11 contributors. Though, to be honest, most of them just edited the README to be more readable since I guess my grammar is terrible or something. The rest of the contributors actually contributed to the runtime, either by adding new blocks, or fixing the rendering code to make it closer to Scratch, or, you know, just casually adding support for
cloud variables.
I myself wasn't even planning on adding cloud variables, because that requires a server, and a server requires money, and even with a server, I'm completely lost on how to do anything related to the network. But it turns out TurboWarp has their own cloud variable servers that anyone can use for free using WebSockets. But it turns out it was actually still a bit of work for him, as it took a week to get cloud variables working at all, and another week to get it working on 3DS, and another week to get it working on Wii U. Wii U? Oh yeah, the Wii U port. Grady Link was also the first one to start the great portioning with a Wii U port. The Wii U does support SDL2, so most of the effort, like the rendering, would already be done from the PC port. All he had to do was make the makefile, do input, since I haven't actually done any controller input for SDL2 yet, and do other Wii U specific things like the ROMFS. The ROMFS is something that the 3DS also does. It's where all the assets go, and it's where your Scratch project goes if you want your Scratch project bundled into the executable. The Wii U doesn't normally support this, but luckily somebody already made a library to have pretty much the exact same functionality as the 3DS. After that, it was literally just a matter of compiling the app, and that's it, we have it in a working state already. Now, the Wii U is a pretty powerful console with enough CPU power and RAM that we didn't have to really optimize it at all, but I do know that once we get down to consoles like the Wii, it'll become a pretty huge problem. But for now, let's finish up the Wii U port by adding a couple of nice features. In the 3DS version, I have it so the username block is set to the console's nickname, and Grady Link did a similar thing for the Wii U, in that the username block is set to the current me being used. But wait, did you know that the Wii U has two screens like the 3DS does? The 3DS version does have support to use both screens, so the Wii U will have that same functionality, right? Honestly, I don't even know how dual screen functionality should work. The resolution would have to be pretty high, or I guess I could have it based on aspect ratio, but even then, I don't even know if SDL2 supports using both Wii U screens separately. Maybe Grady Link can figure that out, but honestly, it's not the end of the world if we don't support that. Anyways, after that, and a bit more tweaking, the Wii U port was done. Nice! After that was done, I wanted to see if I could implement audio with SDL2, since at this point, audio was still missing. I had tried to code in audio myself from scratch when first porting it to the 3DS, and did actually get it kind of working, but I had only made support for one audio format, and that audio format just so happened to be the one audio format that Scratch doesn't natively support. Epic. So now I'm back to square one with audio. When hearing that SDL2 has a 3DS version, I started to make a plan in my head. What if I use SDL2 for the audio, and keep using Citro 2D and Citro 3D for the rendering? Because I did try to use SDL2 for the rendering as well, but, man, is it slow. So first things first, I gotta install SDL2 for the 3DS. And, wow, this might be the worst thing I've ever had to endure, because unlike normal 3DS libraries where you can just put in one terminal command to download and install a library, SDL2 is not included here because, what I would come to find out later, SDL2 for the 3DS is very bare bones and people advise you not to use it. Whoops! So I had to spend 3 hours doing trial and error to compile it from source. I mean, some of that was a skill issue on my end, but a lot of that was just that there's little info on how to compile this thing yourself. Guys, if you were thinking about getting into making stuff for the 3DS, use Lua or something, or at the very least, do not use SDL2. After going through that torture, the actual code for loading and playing audio wasn't that hard to figure out. Alright, let's play this song! Any second now. Any minute now. Any second now. Okay, let's skip ahead a little bit. Wow. That took a while. So with SDL, if you play a sound for the first time, it has to load the entire sound into memory before it can play. The problem is, this takes a long time depending on how long your sound is, and the bigger problem is that it freezes the entire game while it's loading. Luckily, SDL comes with two different types of sounds, a normal sound and a streamed sound. Basically, it's the difference between downloading a video to watch it or just watching that same video on YouTube. If you watch a YouTube video, you don't have to wait to to download anything, you can just watch the video. The problem with stream sounds, though, is that you can only play one of these sounds at a time. Apparently, the newer STL3 doesn't have a limit on how many stream sounds we can play, but we aren't using the shiny new tools now, are we? So I decided that if a sound is played from the stage in Scratch, it plays as a stream sound and won't have to load. But there's still the problem of loading sounds causing the game to freeze. How do we fix that? Well, it's pretty simple. Say we have our guy here, let's name him Fred. Fred the Thread. Their job is to do pretty much everything. They interpret all the Scratch code, do all the rendering, load all the images, and they do all this relatively well, but once it has to do something intensive like loading audio, it has to stop everything it's doing until the audio is finished loading. So what we can do instead is introduce another thread. Your sole purpose in life is to load all of these sounds. Now instead of the main thread having to do all the sound loading, it can just hand that off to the other thread and keep going with all the other things that it has to do. Nice, now audio should be done. Oh wait, actually, SDL audio still sucks and makes the old 3DS lag a lot. I had to lower the audio quality on old 3DS to like almost Flipnote level quality and is still lagging, so honestly, I'm just gonna ignore it and pretend it doesn't exist because I'm this close to scrapping SDL2 altogether and just making a 3DS specific audio implementation, but I haven't gone fully insane yet. But anyways, hooray, we now have audio working for all of the platforms we port to, which, speaking of, while I was doing that, Greedy Link finished another port. Ah, the Nintendo Switch. I loved this console. For like 2 years until I forgot about it and let it collect dust. The homebrew scene is one that is pretty low-key, pretty underground currently. It's mostly used for legally acquiring game backups. But I suspect now that the Switch 2 is out, the Switch 1 homebrew scene will flourish and have cool homebrew software like its other Nintendo consoles have. Porting Scratch to the Switch honestly wasn't that hard from what I can tell. A lot of it was just using the code that Grady Link did for the Wii U and also using that for the Switch. It only took a couple of days to complete the Switch port, and all we needed was for someone to test it out on real hardware. But since literally no one has a modded Switch, apparently, we couldn't complete it fully until like 2 weeks later where someone finally showed it working on a real Switch. But by then, I had made a bunch of changes to the runtime that broke Switch support, so it took another 2 weeks to fix those issues, and we finally had the Switch port complete. Again, since the Switch is a pretty powerful console, we didn't have to do anything to optimize it, but this next port, oh boy, this next port was a little different. Bumbling through Brush, my botanical escapade continues with the Wii and the GameCube, since the Wii is basically just an overclocked GameCube, and code that I write for the Wii should work on the GameCube as well. Allegedly. I love the Wii, so I would be the one to code this port. It started off pretty easy, downloaded the SDL2 libraries for Wii, got to writing the makefile, tried compiling it, and it doesn't work. And for kind of just no reason as well. It was like an hour of troubleshooting until I figured out that all I had to do was include SDL2 at the top of the main.c++ file. Why do I have to do this? This is only for the Wii and GameCube, by the way. I don't have to do this for any other platform. Okay, whatever, it compiles. But going into a project would just have it freeze for seemingly no reason. Oh boy. Turns out that since I coded the runtime in modern C++, it didn't occur to me that the Wii just wouldn't support some of these newer C++ features. The feature in question is Chrono, which basically does all the timing stuff, like for the wait blocks and for the glide blocks, and more importantly, it's used to calculate the frame rate. And if it can't calculate the frame rate, then it will just appear frozen. So I had to replace Chrono and create my own timer class with one implementation for the Wii and GameCube, and another implementation for all the other platforms. Luckily, this was the only thing the Wii didn't support, but what about other older platforms that I might want to port this to? Those platforms will probably support even less stuff than the Wii, and I probably just have to rewrite the entire runtime if I even want to support those platforms. I actually did try to port this to the PSP, but the PSP doesn't even support the JSON library that I use, so that's basically a lost cause for now. For the Wii and GameCube, I also wanted to do the ROMFS thing that we do for the 3DS and Wii U. but unfortunately, the Wii doesn't have a ROMFS library, but GradyLink did suggest that I could port the Wii U's ROMFS library to the Wii and GameCube, and after initially being like, no, I'm good, that'll probably be hard, I actually looked into it, and most of the code isn't even Wii U specific. I could just replace the Wii U code with normal C code and call it a day. So this was technically the first time writing code in C, and the first time making a library. It was literally like 2 hours of work and a few lines of code change, but yeah, now the ROMFS is working on the Wii and GameCube. After that, I thought we were done. But then came the memory issues. You see, images take up a lot of space in RAM. Let's use the old 3DS for example here. The old 3DS has 128 megabytes of RAM. Only 64 megabytes is usable in Homebrew apps. Let's say we have a 2 megabyte Scratch project and a bit of extra RAM that the runtime uses. Now let's say you have an image. This one is pretty small in size, so its pixel data doesn't take up that much space in RAM. Now let's say we have a much bigger image. It doesn't matter if you make the file size low by compressing it. As long as the dimensions of the image is still high, it will still be stored in RAM completely uncompressed. Too many of these images and you're either not able to load any more new images or your console just crashes. This is why I don't think we'll be able to port this over to low RAM consoles like the DS and DSi, just because of how little RAM they have. Now, there's a couple of things we can do. On the 3DS side at least, you can compress the image data so that it's 4 times smaller in RAM. I was able to do that if you compile your Scratch project with my runtime, but I wasn't able to figure out how to do it on the 3DS itself. Then I thought, what if I just track the amount of memory each image uses, and if the memory gets too high, I just free the images from memory? This might mean images will take longer to load now, but I'll take that any day over images just not working at all. Anyways, I think now we can call the Wii version done and done. By this point, we had a whole list of platforms that it was possible to port this to, but after the most popular ports were done, I honestly didn't think there would be any more. That is until a new contributor came to the scene and wanted to try to make a port to the PS Vita. Now, I love the PS Vita. Hypothetically, I never actually owned one, and I do really want one, but it's out of my budget, honestly. Doggo has one, however, and wanted to port Scratch to it. He's apparently new to developing in C++, so if he completes this port, does that mean my code is readable enough for even newer devs to understand? He started the first couple of days by trying to get it to compile. Apparently, converting the images to something the PS Vita can understand is quite the task. Once he did get it to compile, though, I actually had to go in and refactor the file that handles opening Scratch projects, because at this point, every platform so far had a different spot it wanted to open Scratch projects at, and the file was looking like the aftermath of World War II. So I cleaned it up, and all Doggo had to do now was define the folder Scratch projects should be found in this function. After that whole thing, it booted to the main menu, and all we needed to do was fix the controls, audio, and some other things. A few days later, boom! The PS Vita port was officially finished. Man, what a day. We now have Scratch on 7 different consoles, with ports to both the original Xbox and the PS4 on the way. During this time, I was able to add more features to the runtime, like vector images and 3D support for the 3DS. Sure, using 3D makes it a bit laggy since the code I wrote for it is pretty bad and unoptimized, but dude, if you have a 3DS and you can see it in person, the 3D effect is so cool with this, like, oh my god. But yeah. That's it. I really wanted to try a PSP port or even a DS port, but that would require a lot of code to be rewritten, and summer is quickly ending, so I will not have enough free time to do that anymore. I know GradyLink still has a bunch of stuff planned, like custom extensions and pen support, so that'll be fun to look forward to. Anyways, it's the end of the video now, so you know what to do. Oh yeah, it's that time. You are being influenced. Ooh, you will subscribe to me. Ooh.